According to theCUBE research, 39% of organizations are using WebAssembly or WASM in modern development. My name is Paul Nashawaty, and I'm the practice lead and principal analyst for the app dev practice at theCUBE Research, and I'm coming to you live from Open Source Summit North America 2025. Right now, I'm joined by Matt from Fermyon. Matt, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
Great to have you on.
Yeah, it's always a pleasure.
Want to tell the audience a little bit about you and Fermyon?
Yeah, so at Fermyon, we are focused on building the next wave of cloud computing, and we use a technology called WebAssembly in order to do that. We're really excited about both the participation that we've had over time in open source communities and in developing a serverless application style, and more recently in the work we've been doing on edge and on kind of this emerging AI agent thing that is actually, I mean, I know it's got a lot of hype, but it is actually genuinely really cool and a lot of fun to be working on right now.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, with all the hype here, and this conference has just been exploding with a lot of just, interest in what's happening in open source. You know, I love it because in my practice, I focus on past, present, and future,
yeah.
Right? And we know that current state and the heritage application workloads, they need to go somewhere,
yep.
Right? And then, but a lot of organizations are not just looking at the current state of containerization and Kubernetes, but they're looking at what's next, mm-hmm. Right? What's happening, especially when you start talking about things like the core, the edge, the cloud, and how to operate around these different technology stacks. So when we think about that, one of the things that was interesting to me is in our recent briefing that we had, we talked about this relationship you have that kind of talks about WASM at the edge and serverless technologies, but the relationship with Akamai. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about that one?
Yeah, Akamai is one of the kind of, they are in fact the original CDN provider. You know, they started in the 90s. They really, I believe Tom Leighton, the CEO of Akamai, sat a couple of offices down from Tim Berners-Lee when they were both at MIT. So the inventor of the internet was highly influential, inventor of the web was highly influential on Tom's work at Akamai. And so they are sort of, in a way, the classic heritage CDN provider that has done a lot to kind of keep up the tempo, to keep meeting today's demands while still facilitating all the things they've done in the past. They came to us maybe 6-8 months ago saying, you know, we're looking at what's happening in both the functions as a service space, the WebAssembly space, and we have this vision that more and more organizations are going to want to push compute power out to the edge. And that's really for two reasons, right? One of them is the emerging, forward-looking one, AI inferencing is going to be better at the edge. The
yes.
other is sort of the heritage one, which is it is harder and harder to justify changing things in the already consolidated working, you know, version of the back-end application. But you can start addressing performance and adding new features out on the edge so that that accrues to your customer base or your user base, but without requiring then re-architecting of existing applications that are doing their job, they just need to be augmented a little.
Yeah.
I seem to recall, I think you, the term you used a long time ago is sort of like satellites, that
yeah.
instead of trying to expand out the monolith to do more and more things, people are looking at technologies that will enable them to park more and more pieces of functionality around that. Edge is a perfect place to park that level of functionality.
Oh, it certainly is. And when we talk about WebAssembly, right, and I'll kind of come back to this because I think this is really important to think about. In our research, what we found is we find that they're at the edge location, we're seeing the growth of 500 to 1,000 production AI workloads at the edge growing in the next 2 years. So what's happening? But when we think about the edge, we think about like the tech stack that's at the edge. There's Intel, there's AMD, there's ARM processors, there's servers, there's like little no servers, there's compute, there's all sorts of things in closets, things mounted on walls, you know, all sorts of things happening, right? And what a better like use case to uh-huh. use something that's, you know, an application development platform like WebAssembly. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, because WebAssembly, you know, you compile it once into this, platform neutral, operating system neutral binary format, and you can run it in a huge variety of environments, not just Windows and Linux or ARM and Intel, but sort of this huge variety of different. which is a fantastic story when you're dealing with edge architecture, because as you just said, you know, POPs have sort of grown, points of presence have sort of grown organically over time. Some of them, you know, have the latest and greatest hardware. Others are have been there for a long time, but are in a very strategic location and might be hard to access and upgrade, but it's essential for delivering content. And so the flexibility of a runtime like WebAssembly works really well on the edge, because the developer doesn't need to know anything about what the infrastructure looks like. The Akamai users really don't have to know what's there. Even us at Fermyon, we don't necessarily need to know. And that's a fantastic way to kind of play into one of WebAssembly's advantages. And with GPUs now rolling out, I mean, this is the promise. If we can get GPUs closer and closer to the edge, you actually need smaller GPUs for edge inferencing, because they don't have to sort of deal with the massive influx of traffic. They're more localized. But as those roll out, then we can take advantage of, you know, WebAssembly's forward-looking aspects and say, oh, and we can already, you know, schedule workloads onto these GPUs here. So we're really excited about what we're going to see, you know, in the immediate future, on into next year and the year after, as GPUs become more and more ubiquitous in those harder to reach environments.
No, super exciting times. I mean, I started the segment with 39% of organizations using WebAssembly for their modern cloud native development. It's not surprising to you, obviously, because that's what makes a lot of sense. But I think that kind of echoes the fact, like, that's why organizations are looking at WebAssembly today. Yeah. You know, but let's talk about those AI workloads at the edge. I mean, that's really where there's going to be an explosion, especially when you start bringing GPUs to the edge, right?
Yeah. And
when we look at bots and agents and how AI is working, what are your thoughts around how WebAssembly works with bots and agents?
You know, and I'll tell a little bit of a story to frame this, right? Maybe just a little over a year ago, I went to an AI conference, and we were showing off some of our WebAssembly AI technologies, and the question everybody asked when they came to the booth was, this is really cool. What do I do with it, right? What do I need a chatbot for, right? Tell me, because I really like this. There were no real clear ideas of what kinds of things people were building.
Right.
And over the last year, we've really seen that shift. And getting to work with Akamai means we've gotten visibility into how it's shifting, because I got to visit their NOC, and you're just watching these, you know, walls and walls of screens as they're monitoring traffic around the world. And I noticed a counter over in the corner that was the number of bots versus the number of humans that were online.
Yeah.
And I don't know if this is normal, but at the time I was there, the number of bots was outnumbering the number of humans on the web at that particular time.
Wow. So that's kind of, it's interesting and scary at the same time.
It is, yeah. And some of those are, you know, the old Google aggregators that are crawling everything out there. Some of them are probably nefarious bots that are doing dastardly things. And a lot of them are this kind of sort of like nascent group of AI bots, some of which are crawling to feed the models, and others which are crawling to gain the context for, like, perplexity in the models that have sort of constantly at the tip of what's going on. But that's a whole new class of things. And suddenly, you have big e-commerce customers, big streaming media customers, you know, the group of enterprises that are not typically the fast movers when it comes to technology, saying, oh, we have a new problem, right? They're trying to come in and do this thing and work around this. So these agents are trying to come in and steal our content. Or, on the flip side, these agents are coming in and we've never had to serve an agent before.
Right.
Now we need to make sure they get the right information in a digestible format for them. Suddenly, we've gone from, I don't know what to do with AI, to, I've got these 9 different problems.
Specific use cases.
Each of which is going to be a little bit different, but all of which are probably going to need an LLM or some other kind of AI model in order to do it. So 1 year, we've gone from blue sky, you know, excitement to very practical use cases that we can tackle and show a lot of progress on in a short period of time.
It's interesting. Again, I would say it's interesting, but it's also very scary. I mean, they have the rapid movement. Let's talk about those AI agents and training them with the right data. How do we get the right data? And when we think about it in the context of, you know, WebAssembly, in the context of what we're doing here with Fermyon, how do you get them to look at the right data?
Yeah, I think you know, essentially AI optimization is going to replace search engine optimization and it's going to be tricky because
it's almost like a recommendations 2.0 type of thing.
Yeah, and I think it's emerging. And I mean, we're in some cases, I think we're kind of actively exploring. I mean, we at Fermyon are definitely actively exploring, but as part of this broader ecosystem that's going. On one hand, I as a content producer want to protect some of my content from an agent that's going to crawl my article you know, spit out the same content, you know, with different sentences somewhere else, and suddenly my journalists are writing their content, you know, with their machine, right? There's a real interest in trying to thwart that behavior, but at the same time, you don't want to spread misinformation, right? So you want to kind of feed your information out there. You want it sort of on your terms, and you want to protect yourself at the same time. That's the game that I think we're going to see played over the next 2 years.
Yeah,
right?
I think that's a fair point. I think fair point. You know, look, I think that I want to pivot a little bit because I think we're here at the Open Source Summit, mm-hmm. right? I want to talk, I'll give a little bit of time to talk about Spin and SpinKube, right? Because uh-huh. I mean, I think Spin and SpinKube, you know, that's one of the, this is an interesting place to be at. Why is this one of your favorite conferences to be at?
Yeah, Open Source Summit, I've been, I think probably 10 years, maybe more than that. And it's always been one of my favorites because it is the one sort of nexus conference for all these different open source projects. You'll run into a Linux kernel developer, you'll run into Kubernetes people, you'll run into front-end designers, all at one conference. And you get the opportunity both to talk to a new audience and you know, share what you're excited about and listen to them and hear all kinds of new stuff. That, you know, use cases I've never thought about before,
sure.
Problem spaces I was completely oblivious to. And this is just one of those very, very rare opportunities to get all those people in the same room. You know, it's been 6 months or so since we contributed Spin and SpinKube to the CNCF in yep. conjunction with Microsoft and SUSE and other organizations. So this has been fun too because it's the first opportunity to say, hey, here's our open source code base, this is how it's governed, this is how you can use it and let people sort of gel with it and see what they do with it.
Super cool, really cool. Matt, you know I could talk to you all day on this stuff. You know I can, I always
yep.
enjoy having a conversation with you, you know, but I definitely think this is great that we were able to get together and have this discussion.
For sure, yeah.
Thank you for your insights. And I want to thank the audience for watching us today and joining us today, and big thank you to you for tuning in. We appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. This wraps up this episode and we'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talent shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge, building an AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. So be sure to follow us on social media. If you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect, feel free to reach out to me at paulnn@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.